kick off the new year with great deals at the Jeep Start Something New sales event. Well-qualified returning FCA lessees can lease the 2020 Jeep Compass Latitude front-wheel drive for $199 a month for 42 months with $2,999 to its signing. No security deposit required. Tax, title, license extra. Call 1-888-925-JEEP for details. Requires due to contribution. Lease of Chrysler Capital. Lessee is responsible for termination fees. Current lease must end by 2-1-2021. Extra charge for miles over 35,000. Residency restrictions apply. Take delivery by 2-3-2020. Jeep is a registered trademark.
Welcome to my show today. This is Debbie Miller, and I'm happy to have back a second time Allyson Forrister. She's the owner of a Massachusetts-based interior design business called Counterpane Interiors. The work that she does in the aging in place division of her business, which is called Thrive at Home, and that's what brings her back to the show today. She was so interesting the last time. I wanted her to return and talk more with us about universal design and aging in place. She's been in the remodeling industry and design area for nearly a decade, and she has positioned herself to be an aging in place and universal design expert. She's a graduate of the Wentworth Institute of Technology, which with a Bachelor of Science in Interior Design. She's a certified aging in place specialist through the National Association of Home Builders and very active in her industry. She's an allied member of the American Association of Interior Designers and sits on the board of directors for the New England chapter of the International Furniture and Design Association. So welcome back, Allyson.
Hi, thanks for having me back.
Glad to have you with us. And let's get started because I know we have a lot to cover, and this is only a 30-minute show rather than a three-hour show.
Yeah. But
anyway, let's start. Now, in session one, you went over this, but in case people don't have time to go back to session one and find it, can you briefly tell our audience again what exactly is universal design and aging in place and what the differences are, or is it the same thing?
So universal design refers to a broad spectrum of ideas that inform the design of anything from whole neighborhoods to individual buildings and interiors, all the way down to products like kitchen gadgets that are inherently usable to people of all ability levels. And then aging in place is, you can think of it as a more distilled version of universal design. Aging in place homes have universally designed features, but those features are chosen based on a resident's specific needs. For instance, not every aging in place home absolutely needs an accessible wheelchair ramp, but perhaps the client would become fatigued from walking up the length of a ramp. That person might be better suited by a set of steps with deep risers and low treads. Aging is different for everyone, and so too is the individual design solution.
Well, how do you suggest that someone starts to plan for a universally designed home if they don't already have such things in place as the features you talk about?
Okay, so the most important step to planning a universally designed home is to decide that you want to live a more convenient lifestyle in a universally designed home. And I know that sounds easy and kind of obvious, and it's common for people to want to remodel their homes when they hit their 50s or 60s because they're empty nesters, they're nearing retirement, they want to refresh the wear and tear that family life has taken on their home. But oftentimes these people in their 50s and 60s are just now discovering that these concepts exist. And by that point, they've been on the anti-aging train for a long time. Because in this country, we have a lot of stigma around around aging, and a lot of people feel that if they plan for the future in this way, then they're admitting some kind of defeat. So
yes, I agree. I run into that all the time with my clients too.
Right. So yeah, so unpacking that stigma and making a conscious decision is definitely, in my opinion, the most important first step.
Well, what do you say to someone who is trying to determine if they can afford an aging in place renovation versus, like, you know, assisted living or moving to a community where they could be taken care of for the rest of their lives? The decision must involve monetary decisions as well as personal wants.
Oh, I have done plenty of research on this, and I actually found some eye-opening figures to share on that. First, 87% of people in this country who are age 65 plus wish to stay at home as they age. And conversely, less than 1% of the current housing stock is age in place ready. So
Yes. That
means that if you want a home that's age in place friendly, you'll likely have to work with an aging in place professional.
Yeah, absolutely. And that is, to me, that is a serious crisis that's looming down the road. Mm-hmm. What are some other...
So from a renovation standpoint, aging in place is extremely cost effective. A one-time home renovation will cost you anywhere from $50,000 to $150,000, depending on the scope of the renovation. Mm-hmm. And to compare that, the average rental rate in an independent living community, like an after 55 community, is on average $2,700 per month. And that calculates to $324,000 over the course of 10 years. Mm. Assisted living and residential care facilities, somewhere where you might need a little bit more support, that has an average of $3,500 per month, which is that's $420,000 over 10 years.
Yeah. If you're lucky, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Right. And then you have continuing care communities, which you might enter into as a healthy person, but you stay there as your health might change. That has an entrance fee of up to $500,000 in addition to a monthly charge of maybe $3,000 per month.
Mm-hmm.
So 10 years is $860,000.
Mm-hmm. It's mm-hmm. not cheap at all. And it also, wouldn't it depend too on where you live in that particular area? I know in our area, $500,000 basically gets you a little tiny studio or one bedroom in a CCRC, and you pay, you know, upwards of $500 to get anything that's decent. So I'm sure it depends too on where in the country you are.
Exactly. Cost of living differs region to region.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely. Well, tell us a little bit. I've talked in previous sessions myself about the village living concept as it pertains to aging in place, but from your perspective as an aging in place and design interior design person, talk to me about what that means.
So sure, the village living concept is not like the sequestered 55 plus gated communities that we all know about. Mm-hmm. Those places have a defined geography, and some models don't even allow young children to visit on weekdays.
Right. No. Yeah. We got to read the fine print. That's for sure.
Right. So the village living concept is a community, but not a geographical destination. They're being created all over the country by groups of older Americans within one neighborhood who are helping each other out with amenities such as social groups, rides to appointments, handy services, and errands, and stuff like that.
Mm-hmm.
The thing that sets them apart from retirement communities is that they're naturally occurring,
yes,
and they're happening in the very neighborhoods that these people have been living in forever.
That's exactly right.
Mm-hmm. Right. So they're happening among the newlyweds next door and the families and the neighborhood children, and the members of these villages aren't moving out of these homes that they've created years and years of memories in, just so that they can have a little support with these types of things that I just mentioned.
Exactly.
So the
concept that is growing, I think it's very important to do that.
Mm-hmm. So you've probably mentioned on some of your other episodes about the village to village network, which is kind mm-hmm. of what these people what these groups of people can work with in order to get a chapter started in their own neighborhoods.
Absolutely. But it doesn't hurt to say it again.
Yeah, right. So if you're interested, go visit them.
Yeah, no, they're wonderful. And they're sprouting up all over the country. I know one up in near the Boston area, it was one of the original ones.
The Beacon Hill. Yeah.
Yes. And it's, we have several in the, our Northern Virginia, Washington, D.C. area that are quite popular as well. And I think it's a very good viable alternative. And I'm glad you brought it up again.
Mm-hmm. It's a great support system, if, especially if you want to be aging in place.
And when you think about, you know, when you need somebody to come in just to even turn your mattress or help you change the sheets, simple things that you used to take for granted. But when you get older and have arthritis and can't do that,
exactly.
It makes a big difference, and don't necessarily have to pay that high monthly fee to be able to get someone to help you turn your mattress.
Exactly.
Well, now that you have convinced us monetarily that we should stay in our home and age in place, what can people expect from a remodel on a typical aging in place? And I know, you know, it's hard to speak in generalities because each situation is specific, but can you talk in generalities about what to expect?
Sure. So aging in place remodels typically touch the hardest working areas of the home. Conventionally built homes simply are not built to be adaptable to one's needs as they age. And there are a lot of details that can be added to a home's circulation, the kitchen, bath, entry, garage, or laundry area that require some sort of renovation. And we all know that renovations can be disruptive, especially ones with a larger scope. So those who plan their renovations while they still have their health will get through the process with less stress than those with urgent needs. But in either case, and especially in the case of those with urgent needs, if there's a decent place where one can live temporarily while the renovation is underway, then the resident will have a much more tolerable renovation experience.
About how long do you, I mean, on a typical, an average remodel, what's the general rule of thumb as to how long it might take? Is this a few weeks, a few months?
You can actually get a lot done in like a 4 to 6 week time frame with a motivated contracting team.
So a short-term rental maybe. Yep. Just saying, do you have to put any of your furniture in storage while work is going on? I would think you might, since it would be easier for the contractors to work if they're unencumbered with furniture.
Yep. So garages come in handy for things like that. Or also you can do something like you can get a pod, storage pod, delivered to your driveway or property, for example. And those can hold a lot of things for you on site, which is usually less of a headache than having to truck everything off to a storage facility.
Yeah, we did that when we renovated a previous home, and I just said, put everything in the pod, and the guy came in the driveway and dumped it. We loaded everything in there, and 2 months later, we had a brand new house inside, but then we brought the furniture back in, and it was great. We didn't have wear and tear on the furniture, didn't have to constantly cover it up and move it around, so that's a very good solution to that.
Yeah, you have to remember that drywall dust can get into everything.
Oh, yeah.
If and you it's leave also, it in your house.
Also hard to get out of everything.
Yes.
What can you tell us about, I know you said the areas that need attention are entries, kitchens, and baths, but what about entries? How can we make them safer for access?
Sure. So the best walkways are thoughtfully designed with attractive integrated lighting and seating. So you want some seating along the way or just outside the door for resting and setting down packages while fishing out your keys, for example. Mm-hmm. Low maintenance plantings and a properly graded path to the door allow for proper water drainage and added curb appeal. Everybody loves curb appeal.
Oh, yeah.
No.
Well, at some point you may have to sell, but hopefully you can age in place forever and ever and not have to worry about that. But it doesn't hurt to have the prettiest house in the neighborhood.
Right. Yeah, everybody else appreciates your curb appeal too.
That's true. That's true.
So no step entries with a flush threshold are best for an accessible home. Mm-hmm. But if your entry has steps that you are able to navigate,